Good evening, everyone. You guys all right?
Yeah!
How many of you are wish you took a nap but didn't? Yeah, totally, totally. I feel you. Turn to somebody, give them a high five, say, I'm glad you're here. Good.
I'm glad you're here too. There you go.
So glad you're here. Hey, you know, as a way of kind of kicking off our evening together, I can't believe it's almost over. Can you guys believe that? All right? I know you guys got a full night ahead of you. I'm going to sleep at like 9:30. I won't tell you where my room is because you're going to bug me. But no, I'm just kidding. But, you know, it's been an amazing journey, and I think God has been doing some amazing stuff. And I just love to hear, just maybe from a couple people, what's God doing in your heart? You know, some of the times that, especially in a group this large, I don't get to hear what God is doing in your D groups. And I just love to hear it. What's God doing in your life? What's God teaching you? Yeah.
It's just that he's talked to me like multiple times since I've been here, and he hasn't talked to me in a while.
Mm.
So that like rejuvenation.
Amazing.
Of my connection with him.
Rejuvenation, connection, speaking with him. Anyone else agree with that? You're hearing from God? Good, good. Let's give him a hand. What else? What else? Someone from over back there. What's God teaching you? What's God saying to you?
I can go again.
We'll give someone else a chance. What's God saying? Yeah, back here.
God's telling me just to be quiet and listen.
Be quiet and listen. Yeah, let's give him a hand. That's good. Yeah, it's so easy when we're so distracted by so many things in life. It just sort of slow down and breathe and be present, right? And this weekend, I think, hopefully you got a chance to do that. What else? Maybe one more from back here. What's God teaching you? What's God saying? Oh, yeah, over here. Yeah.
Trust his plan.
Trust his plan. Yeah. Anyone else struggle with that? Yeah. Let's give her a hand. You know, God has been doing some amazing things, and last night we got a chance to talk about our identity in God, and how there's sometimes things get in the way of us experiencing and knowing who our God is, right? Those are the shackles that we don't want to take off because of comfort or because of fear or because that's all we've ever known. And this morning, we talked about how the only way you can take off those shackles is when you say, Christ, would you take it for me? You and I don't have the power or the ability to do it on our own. The gospel isn't just work harder, do more things, be stronger, be better. It's actually the opposite. It says if you want to gain your life, you have to lose it. And so this morning we talked about how Jesus gives us the power to go from a 1 to a 4, where we've turned our back towards God, we've broken the old covenant, and yet Christ gives us the ability to now see God in a new light, and God always gives us a 4, amen? I think some of you need to hear that tonight, because your view of who God is was not him giving you a 4. It might have been a 1. And I want to tell you tonight, this weekend, for the rest of this week, as you go back, you're going to be tempted to believe that God isn't giving you a 4. And you're going to ask questions like, God, if you love me, why would you do this to me? Some of you will experience those trials and tribulations as soon as you get down from the mountain. And I want to encourage you, if there's one thing you get take away this weekend, it's that God is always ready to receive you. And he makes that possible through his son, Jesus Christ. And this morning we got to talk about that reality that Christ enables us to experience God in a new and fresh way. And tonight, we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit. That when we forget our truest identity, that the Spirit is the one that reminds us and brings us back to him. Tomorrow morning, I want to give you a sneak preview. My wife and I are going to actually speak. You guys okay with that? It's really fun because my wife has never spoken on a stage before with me. She's always helping me with my sermons. I always say you should just speak. And she's like, no, I don't want you to. I don't want to. And so tomorrow we're going to do kind of like a Q&A. And so if you have some questions, things that you might want to bring, we've been thinking of some questions that might be relevant for you. And we want to make it more of a conversation. We want you to pretend like you're sitting at a coffee shop with us. And I mean, honestly, we're not too much further removed from college. And yet, at the same time, we've had a little bit of experience of life. And I think we would want to just share that with you tomorrow morning and make it more of a conversation. Is it okay? So come ready. I hope that's going to be fun. And we're going to talk about identity, what it means to live after post-college, what we needed to wrestle with in college, you know, how we got together, all of the juicy stuff. Okay, so I want to remind us this evening about who we are in Christ. Okay? So if you're taking notes, you can jot these verses down and look at it some other time. But this is what the Bible says about who we are in Christ, our identity in Christ. Number one, we're adopted into his family. Ephesians 1 through 5, we're adopted into his family. We are children of God, John 1 through 12. Third, we are one in Christ and the Spirit. This is what the Bible says about us. When we are in Christ, we are one with him and we are one with the Spirit. We are no longer slaves, amen? Remember the Old Testament and the Old Covenant? We were slaves to sin. We were slaves to the law because the law showed us where we were wrong. And when Christ came, he says, you're no longer slaves to sin, but now you're slaves to righteousness, that you have a new identity in me. We're chosen people, a holy nation. We were picked by God. And God says, you are mine now. You're my son. You are my daughter. And then we are temples of the Holy Spirit as a result of this new identity in Christ. You see, we understand that when we have this identity in Christ, these are the things that are true of us. No one else can take that away. But I don't know about for you, but I think it's sometimes hard to believe that about myself. I've been a Christian for a long time, and there's days in which I doubt this reality in me. And this morning, I had the opportunity to share about my shackles, about how I started this ministry called Epic at Cal Poly, right? My shackles were resentment towards God, and God actually had to transform me. He had to move me forward because he began to show me who my true identity was. My identity wasn't in my ethnicity. It wasn't in my gender. It wasn't in my status. It wasn't in my major. It wasn't in my grades. But he said, Danny, you are now a son of the living God, and that is who you are. Amen. And I began to believe that. And you know what that felt like? The shackles were taken off. And now my identity wasn't in my ethnicity. My identity was found in Christ alone. But here's the deal. God needed to take my imperfections and he needed to begin to transform me. I began to realize that he had made me the way that I was for such a time as this. And I knew that God had picked me for such a time to be able to lead and speak to Asian Americans at Cal Poly at that time. But here's the deal. As our ministry began to flourish, my shackles quickly became somewhere else. You know what it was? Ministry. I began to go, well, I'm leading a Bible study. I'm doing all the right things. I'm leading worship. I'm opening up my living room. We'd have these dinners and potlucks where we'd have like 100 people in my living room. And I was thinking, feeling good to myself. And you know what the shackles I began to wear? It's about performance, about success. What will people say when my ministry grows? Those are the new shackles that I began to get, and my identity began somewhere else. I began to reach and grasp, thinking that my identity could be found in those different ministries. And then something happened. I got a little older, and I was about to graduate. And at the time, our ministry was probably like 20, 25 people. It was a big deal. We were starting to grow, and God was doing some amazing stuff in our movement. And then I left. I left all that I had that I had known about ministry, about crew. I moved to San Diego, and guess what happened? Guess what shackles came after me? You're not good enough. They're going to forget you. Your legacy is going to be forgotten. And you know what happened the year after I left? God doubled the ministry. Guess how that makes you feel? It's like, you're the problem, it's not growing, right, Danny? And I began to hear these voices saying, Danny, it wasn't about you. And I had put my identity and my ability to grow something that I thought was mine, and that was where I began to find my worth. My junior year in college, I was studying biology all up until then. Actually, I finished with a bio degree because at Cal Poly, you can't change your major. It's really hard to. Anyone try to do that? Really hard. Kind of a bummer. But I was studying biology, and I was supposed to become a doctor. My dad has been a physician for his entire career, and I wanted to follow after his footsteps, and it was one of the most challenging conversations I had to have with my dad to tell him, I'm not going to be a doctor. You see, my identity wasn't found in my roles. It wasn't found in my career. It wasn't found in my major or my success in ministry, but it was found in Christ alone, and I needed to hear that. Some of you need to hear that over and over and over again, because just because you put your life in Christ doesn't mean it gets much easier. Our shackles continue to come around us, and we continue to go around the things that make us feel secure and comfortable, because our identity sometimes is found in other people, not in ourselves, and not in who Christ has made us. Can you guys relate with that? Our identities aren't found in our majors. Our identity isn't found in our grades. Our identity isn't found in our ministry success. Our identity is found in Christ alone. So then I became a pastor, and God was calling me out of ministry, or out of medicine into ministry. And I went to ministry. Of course, when you become a pastor, that's a good career, right? That's a good path that I can move forward. And I remember giving some of my first talks at my church and speaking. And I remember going to my wife after church and going, that was the worst sermon I have ever given in my life. Have you ever been there before? Maybe not a sermon, but something else. You're like, ah, what was I saying? What was I doing? And my wife had to gently remind me, this is the most powerful question anyone can ask anybody else. She would say, whose voice are you listening to? Is that the voice of God? Or is that someone else's? Because our shackles keep coming back over and over and over again. Even when we think we've gotten rid of some, others show up. This is what David Benner said. He says this: it is true that I am unique and individual self. I am more than my body, more than my image, more than my roles, more than my mental products and experiences, and more than my community. This is really important. I am myself, and nothing is more important than discovery and actualization of this unique self. Did you catch that? We are not our roles. We are not just what our bodies look like. We are not our successes and our failures, but our identity is found uniquely in who Christ has made us. And that is an important truth that I want you to remember. But what happens when we forget? What happens when we forget? You see, after I graduated college, I was planting a ministry down in San Diego, and I was leading worship, and I became an associate pastor, and I felt like God was doing some amazing work in our ministry, and I continued to wrestle with my identity there. But it got worse, because I felt through those years of ministry that God was actually calling me outside of ministry. And after I finished seminary, I had a couple years in the ministry, and God was saying, I want you to walk outside the walls of the church. You will now become a pastor of other people. But I had to then let go of the shackles I was holding onto the title of being a pastor. It doesn't sound very good to say you're an ex-pastor. And that's what I was. You know that look when you tell people what you do and they're like, oh, what did you used to do? Well, like, I used to be a pastor. And they go, what happened? Right? They're not saying it, but they're thinking it, right? And you're like, well, it's all good. God called me out of ministry, you know? And I had to wrestle with that again. My title, I had to wrestle with the reality that I wasn't what people thought I was. You see, our identity isn't found in our titles. It's not found in our positions. It's not found in what we do. It's in who we are. And God was uniquely calling me outside the walls of the ministry. And so I began to do coaching and organizational consulting. I go into businesses and I help them. I do training and development and consulting. And there was this one time I was consulting with a group called the Giving Keys. Are you familiar with them? Giving Keys is an organization where they brand keys. And I was teaching some StrengthsFinder work there. I had some amazing time working with them. And half of their crew, actually, what they do is they help homeless people get out of homelessness by employing them and giving them jobs. And a lot of them work in the shop. And I was giving this talk, and I was, like, wrestling with, I'm a pastor still. And, you know, and I'm transitioning. I'm trying to get into this work. And I remember at the very end of my talk, one of the employees who used to be homeless, he came up to me, and on a post-it note, he wrote on it, he said, "This word is for you." And you know what the word said? Inside the light. Mind you, the Giving Keys is not a Christian organization. And this guy came up to me in this space, and that's the key that I'm wearing tonight. And he said, "This is the word I saw in you." It said, "Inside the light, because I see light in you." And in that moment, I realized that I was exactly where I needed to be, because he brought me light in that moment. After my talk, I'm going to give you an opportunity, not to give a giving key, but to be a light bearer to somebody else. I'm going to give you a chance to do that this evening. But when we forget, God reminds us, doesn't he? And his spirit actually reminds us of who and whose we are. That's really important for us. So tonight, my point is this. Oh, sorry. My main point is this. How do we remain in this new identity? How do we remain in this identity when we forget? We get that God, we find our identity in God. We find our identity in Christ. But when we forget our identity in the Spirit, it reminds us of who and whose we are. This morning, I showed you a video from The Help. You is good, you is kind, you is smart. And that is what Jesus sings over us. And I want to show the second half of the clip later on when she needs to leave. And this is what she tells her.
Don't go, baby.
Baby, you need to get back to bed.
Presently.
I got to, baby. I am so sorry.
Are you going to give another little girl?
No, that's not the reason. I don't want to leave you. But it's time for me to retire. You're my last little girl.
No!
Baby. Baby. I need you to remember everything I told you, okay?
Okay.
You remember what I told you?
You is kind, you is smart, you is important.
That's right, baby girl.
Don't go, baby.
I got to, baby.
I think this is what Jesus was feeling like when he told his disciples that he needed to go. And in John, he says this, "But very truly I tell you, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you." The advocate is the Holy Spirit who advocates on our behalf. And when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will glorify me, because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. You see, Jesus Christ, when he left, he said, "I'm going to give you something that is irresistible and is going to remind you of the truths of who and whose you are." He's going to remind you of your truest identity found in Christ alone. And this week, as you go back down the mountain, there's going to be so many things that are going to compete for your interest. School. Pretty important. Grades, family pressures, finances, community, people around you. And there's going to be so many things that are bombarding you for your attention. and you're going to quickly lose sight of who and whose you are. And I want to give you an opportunity this week to reflect on Romans chapter 8. So write that down in the note. And this week, I want you to meditate on it, because I think this really culminates this idea of movement from identity in God, identity in Christ, and identity in the Spirit. So I'm going to pick a couple verses throughout Romans 8 this evening, and we're going to read through those because I think they really bring to life what we've been discussing this entire weekend. It says in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, it says, "Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." Can I get an amen?
Amen.
"Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death." Do you catch that? The old covenant versus the new covenant, right? And you see the movement that's happening, that you're no longer condemned, but now you are alive in Christ. If you are in Christ, there is no condemnation. The shackles have been released because Christ has taken upon himself. And in verse 11, he says this, "And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of the Spirit who lives in you." You see, the reason why this is so important, because Jesus, when he died and took the shackles on for us, he didn't remain in the grave. He was resurrected, which was a sign that there's chance of new life. And that same Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead lives in you. Lives in you. Lives in you. If we have faith in Jesus, the same Spirit that brought him from death to life says that will bring us life, because you and I were once dead and he's given us life. Man, it's exciting, isn't it? We have this living hope living within us, and that Spirit that lives in Jesus, that rose him from the dead, now lives in you and me. Let's keep reading. Verse 14. "For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God." You and I are now children of God. "The Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father." You see, we have to let go of the shackles in our lives, and Christ takes that upon his place. And instead of now us being condemned and having a path towards death, Christ now gives us a path towards life. And more than that, he says, "You are once orphaned. You are once separated from me. You are once condemned because of the law, and now you have life through the Spirit who was brought by Jesus Christ. And you are now daughters and sons of the living God. And when you go back home and the world tells you you are nothing, remember this. You have the Spirit living within you, and he has the power to raise you from death to life." Amen?
Amen.
And this is the gospel reality, that this Spirit that is in you, that is raising you up from death to life, is now going to be able to be given to somebody else. We have the power to bring life to people. It's not just a set of rules of do's and don'ts. The gospel is not behavior modification. It's about transformation. It's not about just doing the right things and singing the right songs and wearing the right clothes and not saying bad words. It's about having a life that's so compelling that says, "I should be dead, but I am now alive in Christ. I was once lost, but now I'm found. I was once orphaned, and now I am a son of the Most High God." And the creator of the universe, as you read this morning in Psalm 139, says, "You were fearfully and wonderfully made. I know that full well." And before you were even a concept in your parents' mind, God knew that you would be here in 2018, in this weekend, knowing that you'd be surrounded by some of the amazing people around you. And God says, "I know your story. I know what you've been through, and I'm willing to take on all of your shackles." This is the power of the gospel, that you and I were once far apart, and now we're brought near to God. So this is the movement of the gospel. This is the movement of 2 Corinthians that we've been in, the movement from God, identity in Christ, and now the identity that we find in the Holy Spirit. So let me pick up where we were in 2 Corinthians. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is what?
Freedom.
And we all, who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory, are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Man, that is so exciting. The Spirit is what reminds us when you and I forget of who and whose we are. The Spirit says, Danny, you are a son of the living God. You see, in my journey, in my faith journey, even starting from college, when I moved from resentment to joy and belief of who God was in my life, I still have moments on my journey where I forget who I am. Anyone can relate with that? Some of you are sitting in this room and you grew up in the church and you've been far away. And God's inviting you back tonight. He's saying, I'm giving you a four every single time. I don't care how far you've gone the other way. Others of you are here because you came with a friend. And you heard this was a beautiful mountain and you wanted some good Instagram shots. You heard there might be a cute guy and a cute girl there. And if that was you this night, I'm telling you, friend, God has a very different plan for you because he's kind of saying, come home. I'm the one that made the stars and the heaven, and where you are standing on is holy ground. And the shackles that you've been carrying, that you've been hiding behind that pretty face, won't work any longer. That when we lose our life, we gain it in Christ. And when we say, I've had enough, I'm done, I can't keep pretending anymore, Christ says, come to me. Come to me. And I think this story is really true because we forget at times. And as a way of illustrating this final point, I want to introduce you to my friend. My friend has severe memory loss. And she forgets a lot of things. I'm going to show you this clip because it reminds me that it's really important that sometimes the Spirit leads us back home. Okay? So meet my friend Dory.
I've lost everyone. There's nothing I can do. Shoot, I can't forget. What was I forgetting? Something important. What was it? What was it? It's going away. It's going away. It's going because all I can do is forget. I just forget and I forget. It's what I do best. It's what I do. What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? What would Dory do? I would look around. And, there's just water over there, and a lot of kelp over here. Kelp is better. Okay. Okay. Now what? Lots of kelp. It looks the same. It all looks the same, except there's a rock over there and some sand this way. I like sand. Sand is squishy. Going anywhere. There's nothing here. Nothing but kelp. Lots of kelp and some shells. This way. I like shells.
I like chills. Hello. I'm
Darling!
Oh, my baby!
Let me look at you! I'm never letting you go again!
My amazing girl, you're here! My
baby. It's you! Yes. It's really you!
Absolutely.
Mom, you're actually here! You're...
I am!
And Dad, so are you!
Right here, Kelpcake!
I love that scene. When you and I are lost, there is a God who is searching for you the entire time. That when we have lost our way and we actually turn to God and say, "Where have you been this entire time?" It's actually that he's been searching for us. And the shells are reminders that the Spirit is actively drawing you back to the living God. And he's saying, let me show you who you are. And it's so easy to forget. It's so easy to forget. So I'm going to ask the band to come on up. And as they do, I'm going to invite you to close your eyes. Your heads bowed and your eyes closed. I want you to think about that image of the shells that have been placed in front of you that remind you of where home truly is. And I don't know where you are tonight, and I don't know where you've come from, and I don't know the situation back at home, and I don't know your circumstances and the struggles that you go through and the patterns that you want to break. But there's some of you tonight in this room that haven't been home yet. You've seen shells placed along the way, and I would imagine that this weekend is a shell in front of you. And God is saying, come home. That you've been carrying these shackles for far too long. You've been running this race all by yourself. That the burden you've been carrying is far too heavy and you've forgotten. And so, in just a moment, I'm going to invite you, if that's where you are, you're in a place where you're saying, I've never experienced the compelling and the transformative love of Christ. And I don't really know what it means to follow Jesus, but I feel like that's the step I want to take. And all the shells are leading towards this Jesus. If that's you, in just a moment, I'm just going to have you raise your hand. And for those of you who have maybe gone to church for a long time, you know of who Jesus is, but you know him in your head and you don't know him in your heart. I'm going to have you raise your hand as well. That you are in a place where you're saying, God, I want to come back to you. So with eyes closed and heads bowed, I want to invite you, if that's you tonight, if you are saying, God, I want to know you, and I want to know myself as a result of knowing you, go ahead and raise your hand. If that's you tonight, if you're saying, man, I want to have a relationship with the living God, thank you. Yeah, I see you. See you. Just keep those hands raised. If you're in a place where you're saying, I want to know who this God is, to have a real relationship with him, keep those hands raised. Okay. Go ahead and put your hands down just for a moment. With your eyes closed and head bowed, for those of you who raised your hand, I'm going to invite you to be really bold this evening. In just a little bit, I'm going to ask you to turn to a friend in just a little bit, not now, and tell them that this is what you want to do. And staff, if you're available, I'd love for you to be available at this time as well. And we're going to have some staff, we're going to have some extended time of worship in just a moment, and I'm going to allow the staff to kind of stand at the edges. And if you were someone that rose your hand, I'm going to give you an opportunity to pray a prayer and say, God, I want to know you. I want to experience you, the living God. Now, in just a moment, for everybody else in this room, I want you to think about the names that you feel like God is inviting you into. This morning, I invited you to take a name tag. And during your quiet time, I wanted you to reflect on the names that you hear in your head that are untrue. And then today, as you heard the words, you is kind, you is smart, you is important, I wanted you to find a new name. A name that says you are loved, your grace, your peace, you are kindness, you are goodness. And if you got a chance to write that, I want you to go and pull that out. Go and pull out those name tags. If you lost yours, I've got some in the front. I've got some in the back. We have some people that are going to pass it out. If you lost yours, it's okay. Go ahead and raise your hand. We've got a few here. Jacob. And for just a few moments, I want you to write a new name. A name that you feel like God is inviting you into. A name of hope, a name of truth, a name of joy, a name of peace. And I want you to write a name that's about love. And it might just be that. Because we have our earthly names, whatever those might be. But the name that I want you to walk away with tonight, that you want Christ to speak into you, go ahead and write that down. A name that is true of who you are. It might be a son or a daughter. It might be beloved. It might be cared for. It might be loved. It might be kind. And it's a new identity that you want to find. It's quite interesting in the scriptures, when people have an encounter with the living God, their names change. Paul, our author of 2 Corinthians, used to be Saul. And Christ now says to you, these are the names I want you to have. Okay, so I want you to write that down. I want you to think about that. And that's the name that you want to embody. But you remember what I talked about earlier this evening, that you and I have the power to give light to somebody else. So as the worship begins to unfold, we're going to do a couple different things. I'm going to have the staff join us on the side. I'm going to be down here to pray with anyone that wants to pray with me. I'd love to pray over you. And if you feel called, I want you to take that name tag. And I want you to find someone in this room that you feel like God is inviting you to give that name tag to. Because you see, the name that Christ gives us is not just for us. It might be for somebody else in this room. And I want you to say, I feel like God is saying that I should give this to you. I don't know. Take it for what it's worth and hold on to it. Put it in your Bible somewhere. Stick it on your bottle. I don't know what you want to do with it. But for the next few moments, as the worship goes on, I want you to begin to think, who might God be calling me to give this name, this truth, this shell to somebody else that they might be able to experience that? And for those of you who rose your hand saying, I want to come home, I'm ready. I'm done carrying the shackles all by myself, and I'm ready to give God a four. I want to invite you to find a staff member, find a friend, come up to us. We want to pray with you. We invite you into this transformative relationship with the living God that now calls you a son or a daughter. So let me pray for us, and we'll let the worship team lead us. God, we love you, and we're so grateful for you. And thank you that you are so longing and so waiting to open your arms and give us a hug, to give us a four, even when we gave you a one so many times. We say, God, I don't need you. I'm good. I've got to figure it out. Or God, you don't know my story. You don't know the crap I've been through. Or God, who am I? Why would you love me? Why would you chase after me? Why would you give up your son for me? And you say, God, I don't need you anymore. And some of us in this room tonight are saying, I need you, God. I'm desperate for you. Without you, I'm lost and I've forgotten. Tonight's the night where God's saying to you, come home. Take off your shackles, because the place you are standing is holy ground. So thank you. Thank you, God, for tonight. Thank you that your Spirit brings us back to the cross and reminds us of who and whose we are. Let's worship.